Now available on Tata Sky channel number 526.
Welcome to Magicbricks Now. You're watching The Urban Debate. This is India's first property channel. I'm Fede Souza. Let's take a look at the top headlines of the day.
Building permissions will now be sanctioned in just 30 days. Common single application form has been devised for online submission.
Well, you heard it right. Delhi's building bylaws have been revised to provide construction clearances in less than 30 days. This will form the base for rules across the country in the future. Speedy approvals, single window clearances are in store now for Delhiites. Mumbai's RA residents challenged the Maharashtra government's decision to allot 3 hectares of land for a metro car shed in the eco-sensitive zone. The case is being heard by the National Green Tribunal. The NGT has demanded responses from the MMRCL. Well, good evening to you. In our debate today, we're going to attempt to decode the property market in South India. Over the week, our phone lines have been ringing off the hook for a lot of callers who've asked us about the southern market being a stronger market. Is the market still healthy? Where would they ideally have to invest in, say, Chennai, Hyderabad or Bangalore? Or are there any other southern cities that are currently good investments at this point? Well, what we're going to do is talk about each of those cities and try and figure out where you should be investing your money. Now, as per the MagicBricks.com report on the prop index made exclusively to this exclusively available to this channel, Chennai has been an outperformer this quarter despite those floods. Today on The Urban Debate, we've put together a special panel of experts dedicated to answering all of your questions about the southern market. Joining me on the show today, Jayashree Kurup, Head of Content and Research at MagicBricks.com and the author of The Prop Index. Arun Kumar, Founder and Managing Director at Casa Grande, joins us from Chennai. Trivita Roy, Associate Director at GLL, joins us from Bangalore. We'll soon have someone join us from Hyderabad as well. The idea with this show, of course, like we always do, is to open up the phone lines and have you call in with any question you might have. Jayashree, I'm going to start with you first of all. And we normally talk about the Bangalore market when we talk about South India, but I want to focus on the Chennai market. Now, given the prop index, and we'll put that up on the screen so our viewers can take a look at it. Given the prop index, Chennai came out tops this quarter. It's up 3% in just that one quarter, higher than any other city in the country. It's the best performer in spite of that flood. And we're also talking right now about a large infrastructure boost that will come up in the Chennai market. Now, I want you to take a look at your screen. The arrows or the bars pointing downwards are markets that have actually lost value in the last quarter. The bars pointing upwards are the ones that have gained value. You'll see the highest bars are for the city of Thane and the city of Chennai, which is what we're focusing on this particular show. Jayashree, Chennai turning out to be a dark horse there in the national market, not just the South Indian market. What are the options you think in terms of investments if we're looking at Chennai?
See, Faye, the Chennai market is actually benefiting from the fact that business has, its drivers are not only the IT sector, but also manufacturing. So two strong economic drivers, despite the fact that the economic performance has not, India's economic performance hasn't peaked. We still see that these are good drivers for the Chennai market. And it is a very focused market. A lot of people come in to work in Chennai, and these people drive the new developing areas, which are the OMR, DCR, peripheral markets where a lot of commercial development is happening. However, in Chennai, one interesting fact is that core city areas like Annanagar and so on have seen a lot of redevelopment and therefore new stock in the market, and that has also been getting favorable response. All this put together, the Chennai market has performed well, and going forward, I think I would still give it a thumbs up because it has had commercial space take up like never before in the last 1 year. 2015 has been the best year yet.
All right, I want to bring in Trivita Roy here. Trivita, when we talk about Chennai, I want to understand from you, Jayashree just said, of course, commercial property in Chennai has not had a better year than the one that we just closed, perhaps, financially. Tell us what kind of demand you're seeing for commercial property in Chennai. Is this the kind of demand that will create housing demand as well? Because we know that when it's BFSI and IT demand, when that sort of commercial property comes in, then those are the people who buy and rent homes. But a large amount of manufacturing demand, for example, doesn't create housing demand in turn. What kind of demand are you seeing in Chennai?
So the demand in Chennai definitely is driven a lot by the IT leasing, and also a lot of leasing that we see by BFSI companies. So if you see Yes Bank, Citibank, and BNS Paribas, so these takers have taken a lot of space in Chennai of late. We have seen that. So these will definitely drive the demand these will definitely drive the demand going forward for residential also, because we generally see that the commercial demand slowly percolates translates into residential demand, because there will be a lot of hiring happening hiring translates to both investor demand, because people know that a lot of newcomers will take up rent spaces, and as well as people who are working over there have settled down, they would also buy houses. So definitely the demand side coming from commercial leasing is strong. We have seen Chennai is really showing that strength in demand part. And not just this, as you mentioned, manufacturing also, we see that there is a demand there. Hello.
Yes, Trivita, tell me this, when you say there are a lot of BFSI clients, banking
also
clients,
also we see a demand.
Yeah, when you see a lot of banking clients coming to Chennai, what neighborhoods are these? Is this new property coming up in, or these new business districts coming up in? And as a result, where will we see the housing demand come in?
So the locations that you're talking about, Yes Bank has leased about 7 lakh square feet of space in the western part of the city near Ambattur. So that is an upcoming location. So there definitely today the focus is more towards mid to affordable segment housing. And if you look at other locations where these banks or other IT spaces are being taken up, is particularly in the location which is the pre-toll, we call it as a pre-toll OMR location, so before the toll gate. Those locations are also seeing a lot of tenant preferences by IT tenants and BFSI. And definitely the housing demand is strengthening there. That will be a location to look at, because that is catering to both. The prices are also not that high. At the same time, there is supply coming there. At the same time, it is also catering to the housing demand for the IT spaces around. So that definitely comes as a hotspot. Ambattur, as I said, is still emerging with this Yes Bank space taken up. And other emerging locations would be beyond OMR toll gate as well, which would be for more futuristic location. So these would be the areas that would come up today as because of the leasing. As Jayashree mentioned, that yes, there is a lot of activity happening in the central part of the city as well. And that is catering to more at the higher segment and the luxury segment housing. So we see a uptake, a demand pickup there as well. So these three zones, I would say the central zone going south towards the OMR, and a little towards the west would be the areas to look at.
All right. Three zones there. Picks right now if you're looking at investing in property in Chennai, Ambattur being the top of those. Arun Kumar, I'm going to bring you into this conversation. Very interesting piece of information that the Magicbricks.com prop index has popped up. It says basically when customers are looking at projects or property on the outskirts of the city, they prefer ready to occupy because they don't want to take on the risk. But when they're looking at something that's inside the city, they don't mind taking something that's under construction. Is that your experience as well? And can you tell us why there's such a massive difference there in the thinking in Chennai?
See, first and foremost, in any market today, as the market has slowed down quite a bit, customers have preferred to buy the more finished homes, because lot of projects with huge supplies have come in, and those projects have not taken off to that extent. Considering that, obviously, if a ready-made project is available where a project is completed, a customer would prefer that for sure. Having said that, if the builder has a good repute to deliver it on time and if he is offering it at early stages at good prices, people do go ahead and buy those projects also. So it is not exactly tilted to that. But having said that, it is not truly a city-specific or a outskirts-specific kind of scenario because it is the same. If there's a good builder with good repute, even in the outskirts, they do buy it even at early stages. And if it's possibly inside the city, and even if it is, if the builder's repute is not up to the mark, they look out for a kind of a more finished homes. So that's how it kind of pans out.
Well, Arun, tell me this, from the projects that you're planning on launching, the land that you've acquired or your futuristic plans for the company, what are the neighborhoods that you're looking at? What are you bullish on right now?
See, OMR is one of the best locations for Chennai for sure because actually there's a huge pent-up demand. In fact, the flood time actually, see this whole spire, up hike of demands and purchase which has happened in the last 3 months, I would attribute it to the pent-up demand which must have happened during the 2 months of flood which affected and make the market pretty slow. So that could be a primary reason. But having said that, the location which we can look at to invest and Chennai is very bullish, should be bullish on is OMR, the South Corridor, which is one of the best. The supporting corridor ECR is also becoming a good residential pocket for high-end residential developments. And GST with all its rail and rail road connectivity, etc., has also been a fantastic corridor to buy. And the western suburbs, it includes locations like Manapakkam and Porur, they are all very, very much in the heart of the city, but have not moved the prices too much. Like a Manapakkam kind of location, which is closer to the DLFs and so on and so forth, DLF IT Park, is in the range of about 5,500 rupees per square foot. So those kind of locations have also been very, very good. So and the southern tip, maybe the Gudanjari pocket, the Tambaram, which is part of the GST road, etc., have all turned out to be one of the better locations to invest. And obviously, the Sriperumbudur, Oraganam locations have also been good for the affordable categories, and they've also done very well in the market.
All right. So Ambattur and OMR being reiterated there as interesting picks to look at if you're looking at property. GST, Porur, Manapakkam, we also talked about. Sriperumbudur, we talked about for affordable housing. Jayashree, you're the one who put together that entire index. From what you're looking at within Chennai and the growth that you possibly expect from these neighborhoods, what are your picks of interesting locations to invest in or interesting locations to buy property in Chennai?
We thought a little out of the box and we said that while these other locations, OMR, GST, Oraganam and so on, are doing well, we said if you were an investor and you've seen that this market is rising, so you want to invest in the city, I would say that there are two locations that we've picked up, Kelambakkam and Podur. Now, the reason why we've said this is because they are roughly in the 3,500 to 4,000 per square foot category, and these both have good drivers right now. These are two areas where if you hold your property, invest today and hold your property for the next 3 to 5 years, you should be able to get about a 35% return. The other locations that we have talked about, those are the areas where if you're an end user, do pick up because there is lots of property in the market.
Jayashree, before we move on to other locations, I just want to come back to the fact that you talked about Podur and Kelambakkam, and you said that because it's in the 3,500 to 4,000 rupees a square foot bracket. Now, I want to ask my producer to put up that pie chart one more time of the kind of supply we're seeing in Chennai broken up based on the price per square foot. It's going to pop up on your screen. We'll notice that 60% almost, Jayashree, of the supply that's coming up in the city is in the 3,000 to 5,000 rupees per square foot range. That's on your screen right now, supply of homes. There you have it. That entire red portion of 62% of the supply is in that range. So what makes then Podur and Kelambakkam so special?
Both these areas, the infrastructure is coming up well. They are well connected to the commercial areas. And between a 3,400 and a 5,000, there is that little bit of arbitrage possible. And we feel that those areas where the 3,400, 3,500 per square foot category, if you have good housing coming up there, pick that up and hold it for another 2-3 years, it will reach the 5,000 per square foot category, if not more, depending on the market cycle. And that gives you that cost arbitrage and it is good for an investor.
Well, I want to bounce this idea off Trivita as well. Trivita, do you agree that if I'm buying property as an investor right now, the 3,500 bracket would possibly give me some room for growth, and that's what I should be looking at? Chennai specifically.
Yes, yes, very much, Faye, because, you know, this is the bracket where there is a bandwidth of appreciation as well, because the moment a property reaches that above 6,500 to 7,000 range, what we have always observed is that buyers, the number of buyers slowly start thinning down. We also see that the appreciation can't happen fast. But now if a property is in that range of 3,500 ranging to 4,000 rupees, that becomes a very easy, very pocket-friendly property to invest in. And also it is a property which also can see that appreciation because the sales move faster. So these kind, and as Jayashree mentioned, we're having good infrastructure and having a supporting demand because of the commercial developments around. This can definitely be a ticket size to look at and buy, and which will see appreciation, and it can go up to 5,000. And Chennai, we have seen that comfortably has seen good appreciation over the years. On an average also, we see a good 10%, if I take the overall city, it sees comfortably a 10% appreciation. So in that terms, I would say that yes, that is predictable.
Jayashree, also tell us, I know you had a couple of more ideas to share with us in terms of investments. What are the other locations you're looking at right now?
I would say go. We've seen that in the January. This is a quick take on the next prop index that will hit the markets in by the middle of April. We found that there has been a slight drop in values in those areas that were affected by the flood. But we feel that this is a temporary phenomenon because it hasn't gone down in the consumer's wish list. Those top 10 localities have more or less remained where they are. And we believe that that is the strength of the Chennai market. There has been a small fluctuation because of the floods. People have had a weak sentiment. But it's kind of bounced back. And the, with the metro coming up, with the rest of the infrastructure that's coming up, I think Chennai is poised to bounce back. Surprisingly, nobody has talked about how that drainage problem is going to be fixed. I don't think there are any solutions that have been offered.
Well, Arun Kumar, I know that developers in the city got together, had a conversation with the state government about, like Jayashree mentioned, the drainage problem, the sort of pain that was inflicted by the floods on not just the citizens, but also the market in general. What sort of responses have you received from the state government? What plans is the state government considering at this point?
In fact, the state government has been extremely proactive in making all the necessary observations on what has happened during the floods. In fact, what is good is it has exposed all the defective pockets in the city. And it is good that it is exposed. It's unfortunate that it's happened over such a unfortunate event. But it's exposed it, and they have all been surveyed pretty well. And all those low-lying areas who have understood and they've thoroughly mapped it, and they've evolved plans of evolving, fantastic drainage systems. In fact, a lot of locations where we're developing around, which did get affected by some bit of floods, have all been mapped out very thoroughly. And actually, we have also pointed it out to the government. Actually, the government has taken necessary actions to relay the necessary, drainage lines, which could possibly take the water out. So I think that is augured well per se, and the state government has taken a lot of measures. Having said that, obviously, you cannot expect only the government to kind of roll in, assuming we are making a huge township development in a location. We as developers also have a responsibility to ensure the drainage lines and the way the property is developed in terms of height of the development and so on and so forth is planned in such a way that it is planned for floods. Now that we've seen it and we've experienced it, if at all it were to happen again, it can happen for sure again. We should be well planned, and our developments or our site should be in a better equipped to handle it. So it has to be from the developers and from the government's end. And you cannot only expect the government to kind of do the basics. No, they have done their bit, and we are expecting them to do more from here on.
All right, so we're going to keep a close eye on the Chennai market. G. Ram Reddy, President CREDAI at Telangana, joins us as well to talk about the Hyderabad market and the new markets coming up in that part of the country and the state. But I have someone on the phone line. I'm going to give our viewers a quick recap before we go to Chandrasekhar, who's on the phone line from Chennai with a question for us. These are the neighborhoods we talked about in Chennai: Ambattur, OMR, GST, Podur, Kelabakam, Sriperumbudur, and Oragadam. Chandrasekhar is on the phone line from Chennai. What's your question, Chandrasekhar?
Yeah, my question is, you know, I am looking for a 2 BHK, you know, in the 30 to 35 lakh rupees budget.
Right.
So I have selected, you know, Aragadam as a selection as an area. So I would like to know what is the prospects of that area in the coming times.
Mm-hmm.
And if there, I also understand there are some already, you know, built-in houses ready to move kind. Okay, suppose I want to invest there around 30 to 35 lakh. Can I get rental value over there?
Okay.
So what are the 2-3 projects you can suggest?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that is what I want to know.
Okay, Chandrasekhar, quick question for you before we answer your question. Is this a pure investment? Do you hope to live here at some point? And what sort of time horizon do you have? And when? How long can you hold on to this investment?
You see, actually, I am a Chennaiite, but presently I'm living in Pune.
Okay.
So basically, I want to invest over there so that, you know, maybe after 2-3 years down the line, when I move over there, I have some flat over there.
All right. You're far away from home, but hopefully the food at Vaishali provides some comfort there in Pune. Jayashree, I want you to answer this question. 30-35 lakh rupees, that's the comfort zone we were talking about in terms of buying property. He did mention the fact that he's looking at Oragadam. He wants to maybe look at rental returns. Now, tell us what the rental returns are like in Chennai, because if he buys something that's ready to occupy, the possible appreciation that he can expect will be lower because that price would have already been priced in, right?
Sure, it would. But I would say that in Oragadam, there is a revival of interest in Oragadam, as I see it on the site. Probably because that is a manufacturing, it's close to the manufacturing hubs, and there is some amount of, corporate office activity also happening there. There is a lot of stock there, and once the manufacturing activity picks up steam, you will get rental demand there. I don't think the rental demands are as high as in the IT belts. However, there is steady demand, and I see that people are looking at Oragadam as an investment destination. In Oragadam right now, I see that the premium properties where, you know, the senior VPs, the senior managements of the manufacturing hubs are actually looking at premium property and paying very handsome rentals in those areas. So I expect that to trickle down, and you might find that there is an increasing activity.
If you say he's not going to gain as much rental at Oragadam, which is currently trading, from what we understand, at about 5,500 rupees a square foot, it's out of that comfort zone. So he won't be able to get a 1,000 rupee two-bedroom, which was his specification. Is there a better neighborhood that you can recommend for him? Higher rental returns, possibly lower prices?
I would say move towards the OMR again. OMR gives you all ranges, and if you go further down on the OMR, you should be able to get the property. But remember, Faye, he's planning to come back. He's chosen Oragadam for a reason. He's planning to come back in 3 to 5 years. Along the OMR and so on, you will have a lot of traffic problems. Oragadam is relatively free of those problems, and probably why he has picked up Oragadam.
All right, let's check with him. Chandrasekhar, are you specifically looking at Oragadam for a reason, or if we give you a better option, will you be able to switch your buy?
See, whatever little research I did, I found that Oragadam is the right place for that at that particular budget.
Mm.
So since I am thinking of maybe 2-3 years down the line to really occupy it, so it's an investment. I found it is good. And OMR I found slightly costlier also. So in my budget, possibly getting two kind of a BHK would be a problem. That is what I thought.
Okay.
So Oragadam is fine for me. Maybe 2-3 good projects over there can help me in selecting.
All right. I also want to ask Arun Kumar. Arun, I know you're doing a lot of construction right now at OMR. Here's a buyer who's looking to buy. Is there something you have in the market that would suit his needs?
Sure. I mean, let me be very neutral here. It's not fine right on my part to sell my project. Having said that, OMR does have
locations where you can buy. If you want to give him a discount via this show, I'll allow you to do it, Arun.
All right. Okay. So hear me out. Actually, see, Perumbakkam as a location in OMR is also a location where you can buy 2 bedrooms at in the price range of about 35 lakhs. Assuming he is focused on, Oragadam, in fact, is a great pocket because it's a great manufacturing hub in terms of automobile, electronic goods, and so on and so forth. Arun Exolo is doing a great project there. Actually, we, in fact, are doing a project exactly opposite Arun Exolo. We are doing a villa development, but we do have villas from 40 lakhs onwards, and Arun Exolo has apartments from the range of about 30 lakhs upwards. So he can evaluate these two projects also, and they are very, very good projects. The projects have all progressed very well, and that's a good location to look out for. And as Jayashree said, it is good to even look out for locations in OMR, including, you know, Navalur, Perumbakkam, so on and so forth, which are pretty close by to the Soringanallur toll, not far off, but and you still manage to get apartments in the range of about 35 lakhs to 40 lakhs at max.
All right. Just a quick look at it. The Casa Grande Ilan, which is the villa project that Arun is talking about, is priced at about 4,750 to 4,900 rupees a square foot. But they're larger apartments, so they wind up being priced between 55 and 77 lakh rupees, if I'm not mistaken. Trivita, are there better options for him, you know, in the market that you can give based on the specifications of the caller?
Well, as Jayashree mentioned, I think there are OMR definitely lies as one of the good locations. But yes, again, because that is where the demand lies, very specific to projects, that would be a little difficult for me to tell at this point of time. But yes, that would be as a location, I think, other or if he, you know, other than Oragattam, if he's looking at any other location, definitely OMR, as I said, the budget and everything fits in well.
All right, Omar, the budget fits well. Jayashree,
if you don't mind,
Arun,
just get in for a minute.
Yes.
I'm sorry. In fact, in these locations like Perumbakkam, Navalur, we are talking about apartments. The project which you mentioned, Casa Grande Ilan, was a villa project, which is why it's about 4,500 rupees per square foot. Whereas apartments, a lot of apartment developments in those projects, including Perumbakkam, in fact, where we have also, it's about 3,300 rupees per square foot. So assuming he buys even 1,000 rupees, 1,000 square foot or something like that, it would fall in the range of about 30 to 35 lakhs. So it is for sure, it's very much in the gettable price bands.
So I'm going to put you on the spot again, Arun. You didn't make any commitment on a discount for my viewers.
anything. Considering the market has been so dull, actually, in fact, for your viewers and for all of you all together, actually, we are in Chennai very happy to offer good discounts. You know, we are also becoming very realistic that we cannot hold on to very steep prices. And if today a buyer is coming to buy and any of our projects, we are happy to kind of go ahead and talk prices. As long as, you know, he is willing to come out and buy from the slumber which he's gotten into, we are very happy to give a lot more aggressive prices. Not us, the whole developer fraternity, we've taken a joint call to say that, you know, today is a market where we'll have to stir up the whole market only by giving a lot more attractive pricing. And possibly that is also a reason why you've seen the 3% spike which has happened. So please do pat on our back for having revived the market to an extent other than whatever could have happened as a macro factor.
Thank you, Arun. And for I will give you a pat on the back for the market in Chennai that's shown life, which is more than we can say for the rest of the country. But to make it a little more specific for the viewers who are watching right now, what sort of discounts are we talking about in Chennai? I know you can't comment for the whole industry, but for your company specifically?
Sure. See, we are looking at, you know, let's say, let's talk about quantum value, actually, you know. For a 50 lakh apartment today, we are willing to go down by about 1.5 to 2 lakhs, you know, as a discount. So that is what we got a more realistic, which means it translates about 4-5% kind of a number. And very, very happy to do that because we have to be realistic today. The market had taken a tank in the last the third quarter of the fiscal. And the fourth quarter had spiked up only because we all went ahead and offered a lot more attractive pricing. And we're willing to bring the customer out of the slumber he had gotten into. And that's the way to do the business. Actually, when a good time happens in real estate scenario, obviously our margins would bump up and we are happy to make that extra margins. And none of you all should feel bad about that at that point in time, because these moments also happens when the market tanks, the market is a lot more flatter, and we'll have to create the trigger and demand only by possibly offering a lot more attractive pricing. And Chennai is extremely price sensitive. The whole India is price sensitive.
Looking at a 30 to 35 lakh rupee home, what is the average discount he can hope for? What sort of room does he have for negotiation?
He can look out for a discount as high as about a 4-5%, which is realistically possible. As long as the price being quoted in the location is realistic. See, there are kind of two kind of pricing which happens in any market. There is some guy who kind of quotes a premium and is willing to offer a logically a bigger, fatter discount. And the other person who's quoting a lot more realistic. So you need to compare an apple to apple. For example, let us say two developers next to each other, let's say are doing 800 square foot, and one guy is quoting at 27 lakhs and the other guy is quoting at 24 lakhs. And the 27 lakhs guy is saying, I'm offering 4
5 lakhs discount, it doesn't make much to me difference as long as this other guy is also offering 1-2 lakhs. So as long as you've ensured you're doing an apple-to-apple comparison in terms of pricing and the product and the developer's credentials, and then establishing and expecting a discount would be a better way to look at it than just say that what quantum discount am I getting, because it's from a reference point of what possibly is the price being quoted. If the builder is being more than fair and offering a lot of, a fair price, the buyer can go ahead and say, even if I get a lesser discount, it still means the same to me.
All right. So we talked about neighborhoods in Chennai. For Chandrasekhar, we gave you some advice on what neighborhood you should be looking at. And as a special bonus for the viewers of this show, Arun talking about discounts that are also available in Chennai. So if you're watching the show right now, you know where to go if you're looking for a bargain in Chennai. I also want to bring in G. Ramareddy, who joins us now to talk about the Hyderabad market. Ram, tell us this. We talked about Chennai, the fact that Chennai developers have gone the extra mile at this point to bring the customer back to the table with discounts. What's happening in Hyderabad on the ground? We know that the market has not shown too much movement in the last couple of quarters. What are you offering your customers?
Hyderabad market is in buoyant now, definitely. Past several years, Hyderabad market is in low. Now the market is already picked up. Lot of launches are being happening, and lot of bookings are being happening. Recently, one of our developer launched in a day. There was 1,000 bookings happened in a one day. So definitely, Hyderabad is doing very good, excellent actually, because of proactive government. Government is giving so many concessions to the developers. Effective government governance is there here. Whatever the past 4-5 years Hyderabad was facing because of this Telangana issue and other things, bifurcation issue, everything has gone. Now everybody is looking at Hyderabad. So
one of the reasons why Hyderabad was slowing down, even from a developer's point of view, was because there was that wait for the bifurcation of the states to happen. There wasn't a lot of policy work happening. We didn't have clarity on policy. Are you getting clarity now from the Telangana government? How proactive is that government at this point?
Telangana government is so proactive. Actually, they recently got a TSI pass. There's a big policy, one of the best in the country actually. So any industry can apply within 15 days. They are going to get the clearances. So government is so proactive about this thing. Even in real estate also, recently we have a lot of demands were put to the government. So almost, more than 50% of the demands, almost 22 demands, the government has accepted, which is totally real estate friendly actually. So, so many concessions have been given, ease of doing business already is there. And a lot of proactive things are happening in Hyderabad, like Google, the biggest campus, apart from the US, is coming to Hyderabad. Amazon also, the biggest campus apart from the US is going to set up in Hyderabad. Today only they have already, groundbreaking ceremonies happened. Today our Honorable Minister KTR has groundbreaking ceremony attended for that. And so many things are happening. Uber is here, and a lot of investments are coming up. Already existing companies are there. Employment is already, a lot of intake is there. Okay. And Tata's with Airbus, they are coming up with SEZs in, already they have started the functioning. So aerospace also is there. A lot of employment, 3,000 employees have been already coming up there. So everywhere, a lot of proactive things are happening in Hyderabad, and a lot of developments are happening. So many projects, other state builders are coming to Hyderabad. They are investing, they are launching the projects here.
Okay, this is true. Google, Amazon, Uber, all of them have very, very large centers and offices in Hyderabad. Jayashree, I'm going to put up the prop index of Hyderabad as a city on the screen, and we'll notice that March 2015 is when we saw a spike in that market. That's on your screen. I'll give it a second. There you have it. If we take September 2013 as the base and we assign that as 100, so what this index does is tell you how the market has moved from September 2013 onwards. You'll see March 2015 is where you see a complete spike. Post that, it corrected. And it sort of stayed stable between June 15 to December 15, which is the last number we have. Jayashree, while it's true that there's been a fair amount of job creation, there's been a lot of investment action happening in Hyderabad particularly, we haven't really seen that translate into sales, have we?
No, we haven't. We haven't seen, you know, while I would say that there is a lot of things positive in Hyderabad, we haven't seen it translate into sales on the ground yet. But I would say that, you know, again, it's another city where a lot of commercial space take-up has happened, especially in the last quarter of the year. And we would say that in that, you know, that translates into residential movement normally within about 6 to 8 months. So you still have another quarter and a half to wait before that translates into sales. Right now, I would say if anyone is an investor in Hyderabad and wants to buy, go towards those, I would still say go towards the IT-driven corridors or and buy around Manikonda, Kondapur and so on, where, you know, Gachibowli and all have seen the spike already. They've already seen prices rising. But Manikonda, Kondapur, close enough to the Gachibowli stretch, but currently at values that are ridiculously low, 2800 and 3500 and so on. Buy in those areas. Again, I would say the cost arbitrage, because it is close enough for it to get the spikes, but it is low enough for you to be able to get a better valuation in another 3 to 5 years. So I would say these are our points.
You know, Arun Kumar, I want to ask you this. I want to pick up from what Ram said, that developers from other cities are also coming to Hyderabad at this point and constructing there. Are you considering Hyderabad personally? Is it an attractive market for you?
Yes. In fact, now Hyderabad is showing a lot of positive signs. We've seen a lot of interest, you know, in the way the market is panning out. We have a lot of interest. In fact, we might pick up some properties near Gachibowli and, you know, a few more locations in Manikonda, etc. So we've seen and evaluated a lot of properties and we are very keenly looking at Hyderabad. In fact, Hyderabad seems to be a pretty well-organized and well-set in terms of the way the market has been operating in real estate. And one more good thing is the quality of developments which have happened in Hyderabad is also pretty good. So it is a very good market and the developers there have done a good job. But obviously, we'll also want to have a share of a good market like that. And we are planning to get into Hyderabad.
Trivita, I'm going to ask you the tough question. Now, all of this stems from the fact that there's a fair amount of commercial property, you know, uptake. And there's also a fair amount of job creation, both in Chennai and in Hyderabad, which we talked about. But we both know that the big daddy of commercial property right now remains Bangalore. So if I'm going to choose to make an investment at this point, based on job creation, based on commercial property uptake, would you recommend Hyderabad, Chennai or Bangalore purely as an investment, purely to increase the value of that investment? What should I be looking at?
Well, Faye, the answer is very obvious. The answer definitely lies in Bangalore, where Bangalore stands, if this year, I mean 2015, it closed at about 10.5 to 11 million square feet of absorption, where Hyderabad stood at 5 million. So you can see the difference. And Chennai also had stood at around that 3-4 million square feet of office uptake. So both, if you compare these cities, definitely as an investor, purely as an investor, if you're looking at these cities, then definitely Bangalore is the market where you can see a faster absorption. Well, again, it depends from location to location. In Bangalore, there are many locations where you see the prices have really touched, have spiked up, and so they remain saturated. But definitely the upcoming locations like the Vartur Road, the Sarjapur Atibele Road, the Kanakpura Road, so the ones which are going a little far beyond, you still have properties which are within that 4,000 square feet, 4,000 rupees per square feet range. And there is the place where it has that bandwidth to, you know, appreciate. So definitely as an investor, if you're looking at a place where you can really make money at a quicker pace, definitely Bangalore remains as a sure shot bet. And especially these locations where you still get it at budget. And the office take up, we actually, if I look at Bangalore today, the office take up going forward is definitely going to be, if I see that there is a lot of pre-leasing that is happening. At this point of time also, I can see a comfortably 3 to 4 million square feet has been closed just in the first quarter, which is a very strong number for the city. And there are And going forward, next 2-3 years also, I don't see the vacancy rates in office space going above 5%. So in the under that circumstance, you can see that the city has very strong economics, macroeconomic pointers to stand strong in the market and keep pushing that demand for residential.
All right. So
yes,
I just want to take
there would definitely be a investor demand, but yes, again, it has to be location specific.
All right, so Bangalore being the strongest market still in the south, although Chennai and Hyderabad are turning out to be very, very interesting in terms of, in terms of investments. On your screen right now, the three recommendations that that we were just talking about: Varthur trading at 3,842 rupees on an average per square foot. Sarjapur Road is about 4,400 rupees a square foot. Kanakpura Road is also 4,400 rupees a square foot. Ram, I know that you have projects in Bangalore as well. For someone looking at an investment right now, would you recommend Bangalore or Hyderabad? Are you more partial to Hyderabad?
Definitely Hyderabad. Hyderabad, because Hyderabad rates are all-time low, actually. I mean, the rates what you are today, we are quoting, it definitely past 4-5 years, there was no much increase. But now, whoever is investing in Hyderabad, definitely they are going to get a lot of benefit. Even though I am doing in a Bangalore also. Bangalore is, as what she has told, I am little, I am not agreeing with her. Okay. Definitely, the market is not that great, what you are talking about it. But Hyderabad, yes, we have seen a lot of positive in Hyderabad. So, we have the projects in Hyderabad and Bangalore. When you compare with both, definitely we have uptrend in Hyderabad.
Okay, so you believe that the Hyderabad market will do better than the Bangalore market?
Much better. Because the price already is lower. I mean, past several years, there is because of various reasons, the prices are lower. And I mean, even when you talk about the sales also, it's a lot of sales have been happening in Hyderabad. Recently, I just quoted, my home, on a launch day, they almost sold 1,000 apartments. So it's a reality, it's not that in a fake or any of these things. So Hyderabad market is much, much better than, other cities, what I feel strongly.
All right, I want to quickly take a phone call, and I will ask both Jayashree and Arun to also give us their picks among the three cities in the south. But Surendra is on the phone line from Hyderabad with a question for us. Surendra, go ahead, tell us what your question is.
Good evening to all of you panelists, Fai, Jayashree, Trivita, and Arun Kumar, and Mr. Ram Reddy.
Yes.
This is Surendra Singhi. Fai, congratulations to you and Magicbricks to focus on South India. As the real estate market being dull and flattered for long time throughout India, it is encouraging to know that Chennai market and Hyderabad market and as well Bangalore market is also picking up.
Okay.
In fact, as I have been in Hyderabad and looking for commercial properties, and I am basically interested in the ROI.
Okay.
Looking at the natural calamities happened in Chennai and still the market picking up, Hyderabad is very static in climatic conditions and natural weather conditions, and everything is suitable for all of us.
Okay.
My point earlier and this time too is pan-India comparative chart of ROI available in commercial vis-a-vis residential property.
Okay.
I have seen many people focusing on only on residential properties, and the commercial properties are not taken at par value.
Okay, Surendra, tell me this. When you're looking at commercial property, you said in Hyderabad, what is your ticket size? How much money are you willing to invest in this commercial property?
No, I have taken one property of 18,000 SFT in high-tech city.
Okay.
And another is 8,500.
Mm-hmm.
And another I have taken at 5,500.
Okay. All in high-tech city?
All in high-tech city.
Okay.
Because it is giving the best return and ROI.
Okay. Do you also want to consider Chennai now? Is that your question?
I am really interested in getting the ROI of all the comparative chart of pan-India, all the major cities where the IT hub and the IT requirements are there.
Mm-hmm. So that's okay. Let me give you an answer to your question. Trivita, I'm going to come to you with this question. When we talk about the ROIs of commercial property in the three cities, he's specifically looking at high-tech city. High-tech city is at 5,000 rupees per square foot. That's the residential property rate. But if you talk about the ROIs on commercial property in Chennai, in Hyderabad and in Bangalore, what are your projections right now at JLL?
I would talk more in terms of market yields instead of ROI, because ROI is very transaction specific. So when we generally do the analysis, we take a market yield, which is typically a portion of which is typically a percentage of earnings that you get year on year on the rentals from the basically the capital value. So typically, if I'm talking about a high-tech city location, a property which is fully leased would definitely give me a percentage of a market yield of about 9 to 10% by default. A very good property would definitely, even the yields get compressed to 8%. But going forward, we are looking at comfortably a 9.5% of return year on year on these properties in high-tech city. Again, as I said, it depends on the leasing of the property, if it is fully occupied. And if you're talking about Chennai typically sees a little more compressed yields, and that has been the city like that. So there you can claim it sees a 6 to 7% on an average. Bangalore is seeing a quicker compression in terms of yields, because Bangalore has seen very strong leasing. And here we see yields coming down to somewhere around 9%. It may go down to 8.5 as well.
Okay.
So that is what is our projection in next one and a half years for these markets. So he mentioned that he's at high-tech city. High-tech city definitely can get.
All right. So this is your answer, Surendra. High-tech city, you can expect 9.5% rental yields, or the yields on the property that you've bought. Chennai being slightly lower at 6 to 7%, and Bangalore between 8.5% and 9% over the next 1 year. So it does seem like you're very well placed with your purchase in high-tech city. We'll have all of those details emailed to you. We're talking about the markets in the south of India to find out where the sharpest investment opportunities are and where you should be investing your money right now in those markets. Remember, we talked about the fact that Hyderabad, being beaten down so much by political turmoil, is currently very attractive in terms of pricing. Chennai, turning out to be the dark horse, has actually seen the most growth in the last one quarter at 3%. Also because developers are offering discounts, that makes that market very attractive. Bangalore still sits on the top of that market, creating the most number of jobs, absorbing the most amount of commercial property, and as a result, is possibly will offer you the highest returns in the south of India as well. On your screen right now, you're looking at the city index change for the quarter ending December 15. That's on your screen. You'll see Chennai there showing the most growth. Bangalore also looking really exciting. Hyderabad remaining largely flat. Major Timms is on the phone line right now. He has a question for us about the Hyderabad market. Go ahead. Tell us what your question is.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, go ahead. We can hear you.
Good evening to everybody.
Good evening.
I have two flats in Secunderabad.
Mm-hmm.
It is at the heart of the city.
Okay.
It's exactly 3 kilometers from the railway station.
Mm-hmm.
And opposite the court office. They are both first floor flats.
Okay.
Measuring 1,050 square feet each.
Okay.
And I'd like to know what is the present going rate for that flat, because I intend selling them.
All right. From our database, we know that Secunderabad is being priced at an average of 2,665 rupees a square foot for residential property. Jayashree, is it a good time to be selling in Secunderabad? Having said that, the fact that close to the railway station in Secunderabad is a great location, but it's still far from those IT neighborhoods we talked about in Hyderabad, in Gachibowli and high-tech city and all of those other neighborhoods. Would you recommend he sells property right now, or is this not a great market to actually come in and compete with the developers, is it?
No, I don't think it's the best time to sell. However, in the latest prop index, what we found is that Sainikpuri and many other places in Secunderabad have surprisingly seen higher demand and rising prices. So I would say wait for a few months more. That market seems to be reviving, and it's a good time to sell. If you see that the market rises another 5-10% more, it's a good time to sell.
Ram Reddy, I want to ask you the same question. Here is an investor who's holding two flats. I'm assuming he's held them for a while because that's a very traditional part of Secunderabad. Would you recommend he sells them? Or if you're saying that the entire Hyderabad market is turning around, does it make sense for him to hold on like Jayashree recommends?
He should not sell now. No. Definitely he should not sell now. Because this is picking up. You see the difference. Next 1 year, you'll see a big change in Hyderabad. Definitely 2016 to 17, you'll big change. I mean, 20 to 30% minimum growth will be there. Minimum, I'm talking about it. So even it may surpass every record actually. So Hyderabad is very buoyant.
No,
you're talking about Hyderabad
20 to 30%.
I'm not agreeing. Are you
expecting that only in the high-tech city, Gachibowli, Madhapur area, or will Secunderabad and Sainikpuri and all of these other traditional areas also see 20-30%? It's a huge amount in this market.
Yes, definitely it is more effective in Kondapur, Madhapur and those areas. But definitely even Secunderabad also is definitely goes up. Because past several years it is flat, but now it is uptrend. So people who are not able to afford it, those places, definitely they will look at the alternate places. And Hyderabad, Secunderabad also, some of the areas, even today also, even you're talking about Maripilli and all, even 5-6,000 rupees per square feet also you're not getting the apartments. There are some other places. So, definitely in next 1 year, you'll see a big change in Hyderabad. Right. Because so many things, a lot of infrastructure, metro rail is coming up. Then government is planned to have a signal-free roads across the Hyderabad. So, all this is going to be reality. It's maybe another in a year or two, definitely there are a lot of changes are going to take place in Hyderabad. 24/7 power already. Many years there was a power shortage. But this year, this summer also, we didn't get any power cut. Not even 1 hour power cut is there.
Okay.
Water, so, there are a lot of, government is talking. Yeah.
Okay, Trivita Roy, if this is true, if Hyderabad is going to see a 20-30% uptick in the next 1 year, then everything you said about Bangalore, it stands challenged. Then we should all be investing in Hyderabad. Do you agree that are those also the numbers and the projections that you're looking at?
No, I don't agree very much with it because Hyderabad, I have studied this market for a good 9 years. And Hyderabad saw similar kind of spikes happening in 2006 and 7. And that was the time where even a same kind of a sentiment was building up that market is bullish, Hyderabad is the place, unlimited FSI. Definitely those are the things. But one thing which we should all understand, what is the appetite of the city? What economic development is planned and how that economic development will translate into a demand. As Jayashree rightly mentioned that it takes about six to seven months even for the IT demand to translate, leave alone the other policies and all these things coming into effect. But I would totally not deny what Mr. Ram said that there would definitely be a improvement in the market. But 25 to 30% is a little too high. I would feel it is still a little bullish side. I would still go by, 15-20% would still be a safer side, that too for good properties. Because as our caller has asked for a market like Secunderabad Station, something close to Secunderabad Station. Now the demand appetite for that market is very different. The market is now not a market where there is an IT inflow. It is not a market where you are seeing like Sainikpuri and all these areas are again different because they are pretty well connected to the IT destination from other routes. And also it is entirely surrounded by the defense location. So it gives that kind of an environment to stay. But whereas Secunderabad station surrounding areas are not giving you that kind of an environment to stay, at the same time, neither is it that kind of an investor-friendly market or a market where a lot of people are coming and taking space. So in that circumstances, it is good to hold on, but expecting too much of a price appreciation for that market would be a little...
I want Jayashree to weigh in on this.
Jayashree, appropriate one.
I've lived and worked in Hyderabad. It's a wonderful city for several reasons. It's very easy to live in. It's very welcoming. And there was a time when Hyderabad was giving Bangalore a run for its money in terms of IT and ITES jobs. We saw that sort of take a beating, and that's when Pune started to become more interesting, when people started to spill over from Bangalore to Pune instead of Bangalore to Hyderabad, which was the traditional move. Now, the entire panel seems to be in agreement to the fact that Hyderabad is going to do really well. The question here is it going to be 20, 25, 30% over the next 1 year, or is it going to be a more subdued growth?
I think more subdued. We should be realistic. I think the metro is nearing completion in some areas. When the metro comes, and I think the Secunderabad uptick you're seeing here is because the metro work is rapidly getting executed, and you can see that that has a positive sentiment.
It's not 20-25%. What are you expecting?
15 to 18% is what I would say in the next year.
All right, I must admit, if you know, 15 to 18% is still fantastic given the market seeing across the country.
Yeah, yeah.
Given the market we're seeing across the country, where NCR has seen a drop in prices, Mumbai has remained flat, Pune has largely remained flat. 15-18% in Hyderabad is very interesting. Diago is on the phone line from Bangalore. Tell us what your question is.
Hi, this is Dilibob here from Bangalore.
Yes.
I have two questions from my side. One is to Ram and other folks here, sir.
Yes.
One of my friends has purchased a flat before 4 years, and in the last month he has sold at the same price. So he was fed up with that, and he sold it.
Where was this property?
In Hyderabad, but I'm not sure about
Okay, in Hyderabad. Property. All right, we're running out of time. You'll have to quickly tell us your question. So what's your question?
One more is, I have invested in Jigme. So where there is planning for a second IAM. So I would like to know what would be the price maybe after 2 years.
Where have you invested again? I didn't get the name of the location.
Jigme
in Bangalore.
Exactly, right. Near Bannerghatta Road.
All right, Jigme near Bannerghatta Road in Bangalore. Jayashree, that's close to the existing IAM as well. What sort of appreciation can he expect over the next couple of years? I suspect he's going to have to hold for longer than 2 years. What's your outlook?
I would say Bannerghatta Road hold for at least 3 to 5 years. The infrastructure needs to be improved before that stretch is going to see a uptick. You're also going to wait till that second IIM plays out. And I don't think 2 years is going to be a good enough period for you to get the best returns.
All right, so it's a good buy. Diego, it's a good buy. Hold on to it. You're not going to lose money, but you might have to hold on for longer than 2 years. But a quick wrap of everything that we learned right now. Given what we look at, when we look at the north of the country, when we're looking at the NCR markets in Gurgaon and Noida, Greater Noida, it does seem like, as always, the stable, steady markets in the south show better returns and more promise for buyers. There's Bangalore, there's Hyderabad, there's Chennai. They all seem strong. Hyderabad is, of course, beaten down enough right now to be able to bounce back, and then we'll show you that kind of return over the next 1 year. Chennai and Bangalore remain strong and remain attractive. On this channel, we'll continue to pay very, very close attention to all of the markets in the south, including the upcoming markets in Simandra and, of course, in Kerala. But I have to wrap up this show. I want to thank our panelists for spending time with us today and answering all of those questions. Remember, a quick reminder on other programming that we are doing on Magicbricks Now. India's water crisis is worse than this year. It's the worst since recent memory. As usual, authorities responsible for our waterless plight are busy passing the buck. At Magicbricks Now, we've begun a nationwide campaign to make those authorities accountable for what's going on in our cities. You'll be shocked to know that most of our cities barely have 2 months' worth of water left. Join our campaign in the fight for water. You can call us, write to us, or tweet out hashtag waterworks. Send out photographs, selfies, voices, if you want videos as well about the water crisis that you are facing, and we'll run it on this channel. We've run out of time this evening. Remember, we're always open to feedback, suggestions, and questions. Stay in touch and stay with Magicbricks Now. Thanks for watching.
You can watch live TV on our website, mbnow.in. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbricksnow. And don't forget to click the like button. You can also follow us on Twitter at magicbricksnow.
To stay updated with all our programming, hit the subscribe button on our YouTube channel by logging on to youtube.com/magicbricksnow.